Good morning and welcome everyone. It's really good to see you all this morning. And God is here with us and we're going to receive our worship service and will bless us with His mercy and grace. Amen. Would you join me in the call to worship this morning? In the Lord, we take refuge from our fears and troubles.
Help us, O Lord.
We feel besieged everywhere, and we don't think anyone cares about us. Listen to us, Lord, and deliver us. The Lord is our hope and our trust.
The Lord will heal and guide us.
Yes, we do not need to fear. Amen.
And our opening songs this morning is Days of Elijah and Supper of My Soul.
The days of Elijah, declaring the word of the Lord. And these are the days of his servant Moses, his righteousness being restored. Though these are the days of great trials, of famine and darkness and sorrow.
Shepherd of my soul.
so divine.
Please be seated. Gracious God, we come to you with day, seeking your guidance and strength. Even before we were born, O God, you knew us. You have always been with us. You've called us to ministries for which we feel inadequate. Help us to understand that it is your love that will sustain and our effort. Give us the courage to place our trust in your abiding presence. God of great expectations, you know how easy it is for us to make excuses for inactivity. We love to run and hide when a task is set before us. We look at the expectation and think that we don't have the abilities, strength, or wisdom to accomplish this task. We think too often that we are doing these things all by ourselves. And we feel sorry for ourselves and angry that you expect so much from us. Forgive our ignorance and our stubbornness, O God. Help us to understand that the opportunities for service that you offer to us also come with your abiding presence, love, and support. It is your love which makes the impossible possible. Turn us around, O God, and place us back on the path of joyful service. Let our work be part of the fulfillment of the mandate of Jesus Christ when he made his proclamation in the synagogue so long ago. In Jesus' name, we offer this prayer. Amen.
Amen. Amen. And now it's time to pass the peace of Christ, and we will remain seated where we are, and you can turn to your left and right and just pass the peace of Christ to whoever is your neighbor.
May the peace of Christ be with you, everyone. God bless you.
Can come forward.
Hi, kids. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
I think you hear me more than you need. So, welcome and bless you. Thank you for coming to see me. I want to talk to you about love. Okay. Be love. Yeah. Would you hold that just so that everybody can see it? So what is love? No, not everybody, just these people. You're going to get tired. See, this works if it is you're not too rambunctious. I have tools like this. There we go. It's here. It's all right. Yeah. Yeah, I am. It's flipped on, but it's wobbly. And I'm not sure what I did. Oh, because the chain is unhooked. I'm so very sorry. This actually is a good tool because my chapel is ancient. We have all of the things you can imagine from the past electronically. There. Okay. So, how do you feel when you are in love? Or love something or someone? He says wonderful. Excited. Sometimes I get butterflies. Yeah? Yeah. Somebody knows. Well, today's Bible verses teach us what God thinks of love. And it's really interesting what God thinks of it because it sounds like perfection. Perfection. Okay, but first, how do you know someone loves you? Oh, come on, the service runs on you. You gotta open your hearts, tell me. What's that? When they do something nice for you? Is that what you said? Yes. Okay. When they take care of you? Yes. When they make an effort for you? They love you. And yes. When they help you? Yes. And Andy, you were going to say something? If they tell you, the words are important. How many of us use love words and not love words? Yeah. People do show you they love you by their actions. And you were all right in when you called that. Now, do they provide a roof over your head? Your parents? Do you know that I had a church service this morning, even though I wasn't expecting one? Patrick came in his wheelchair, and he did not want to leave. So I practiced on him. Now, he doesn't have really good, clear words, but he has a family who's right there involved with him. When Dad got restationed or retired from the military, they moved so they could walk to Faircrest. They see him every day. Are they showing him that they love him? Yeah. The people who put the roof over his head, the state of Washington, and the caregivers, you know what? He shows less love to them. Why do you think? They're getting paid to do it. Right? Your teachers are really good to you sometimes, right? But they're getting paid to do it. Now their heart is in it, and that is love. But as we know, when people do it not expecting anything as a reward, that is love, okay? So, the Bible is filled with the stories of people showing love. And it's showing, when you show love, you're showing God's love. So this is what the Bible says. Love is patient. Love is kind. It does not want what belongs to others. It does not brag. It is not proud. It does not dishonor other people. It does not look out for its own interests. It does not easily become angry. It does not keep track of other people's wrongs. Love is not happy with evil, but it is full of joy when truth is spoken. The three most important things to have are faith, hope, and love. But the greatest of these three is love. So I'm going to show you a gesture. Can you make your hands do this? See, mine is really misshaped, so I took a picture of it so it would look like a heart. I have extreme arthritis, but that's the shape. Yeah, you want to look at? That's perfect. That is so perfect. Yeah, it's a heart. You're looking for a heart. Yes, beautiful. The love that you can draw on is sure love. It's from God. It is certain. It is never going to go away. It's never going to bury. What does that mean? Even when you screw up. Did I say a bad word? Even when you are so, so sorry, take that and know that God is using it to teach you and grow your love. For real. Would you like to hold sure love? But what I want to do after we pray is I want each of you, and I will too, look at someone and say, I love. To say, you could even say, I love you. But this little phrase, two words, can be, I love God. I love my home. I wear a t-shirt with a heart on it, by the way, that says, I love my church. And I work hard, as my ability is, to serve and show it to my church, right? Would you like to hold this one? How about you? But now, let's pray. Can remember your hearts. We're going to pray like this now, because this is a special love thing. Yeah. Oh God of love, let us show love to others even when we might not want to. Let us show love to others even when we might not feel it. And let us show love to others because that shows how much they are loved. Let us be love in this world. Amen. So now look around and find someone to lock your eyes with and say, I love.
I love.
I love. I love.
Hello. Before the kids leave, I want to take care of something here. Do all the kids know what Kristen does? Because sometimes you give these children sermons and you forget a key piece of information. Do you know what her job is? Do you guys know? She's the chaplain at Fircrest, where people with brain injuries and developmental disabilities live. And she preaches every Sunday when she can. To those people, and it's a gift that very few people in the world have. I certainly wouldn't, but it's a good thing she does, and so she knows about love. But I just want to make sure people know that.
And thank you. Now, as the children are going down to their Sunday school, for those of us who are able, may we stand for our scripture reading. It is a responsive reading, and our reading is taken from Luke chapter 5, and we will read from 1 to 11. One day, as Jesus was standing by the lake of Gennesaret, the people were crowding around him and listening to the word of God.
He saw at the water's edge two boats left there by the fishermen who were washing their nets.
He got into one of the boats, the one belonging to Simon, and asked him to put out a little from shore. Then he sat down and taught the people from the boat.
When he had finished speaking, he says to Simon, "Put out into deep water and let down the net for a catch."
Simon answered, "Master, we worked hard all night and haven't caught anything, but because you say so, I will let down the nets."
when they had done so, they caught such a large number of fish that their nets began to break.
So they signaled their partners in the other boat to come and help them. And they came and filled both boats so full that they began to sink.
When Simon Peter saw this, he fell at Jesus' knees and said, "Go away from me, Lord. I am a sinful man."
For he and all his companions were astonished at the catch of fish they had taken.
And so were James and John, the sons of Zebedee, Simon's partners. Then Jesus said to Simon, "Don't be afraid. From now on, you will fish for people."
So they pulled their boats up on shore, left everything, and followed him. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God. Amen. Let's lift our brothers and sisters in need of God's healing grace this morning. Lord, we come before you with joyful heart that you took care of your children, two young ladies, Tale and Philo. You removed their coronavirus and then make them strong once again. So now they are back in school and back to a normal life. Thank you, God, that I will lift everyone in the church. They will keep each and every one of us strong and from all the harm's ways. Thank you, God. Father, at the same time, we come to you with heavy heart for passing of our sister Maror. She left this world last week to be with you and be with her loving husband Jack. We're going to miss her beautiful smile and her faith that could move the mountains. We are so thankful, Lord, to Maror for many reasons. Many of us in this church were taught and be inspired by your exemplified Christian life. We pray for your peace and comfort for their daughters, Debbie and Valerie, and the family. Jesus, today we bring before you the names and situations of people that need your healing grace. Among many, we lift Micah, the grandson of George and Sylvia. Micah has been admitted to ICU once again on Friday for a severe wheezing condition. The parents, Sherman and Renew, are with him this morning. So the grandparents are watching the other children. We pray for your healing grace on Micah, Lord. Strengthen his body, especially his immune system, so he would grow as a healthy young boy. We also lift all the names in our praise and prayer list. We ask for your healing mercies and forgiveness as you promised. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's continue with the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom comes on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen. It's a wonderful Sunday morning, and it's always glad to be back in this place of worship. Amen? And especially so joyful because we are together. We have each other. Today's message I would like to share with you is about out into deep water and let down the net for a catch. It's a sermon about hearing God's call and acting on it. It's been said that Life is what happens to you while you are making other plans. You heard of that, right? The disciples didn't get their call from Jesus when they were looking for it. Rather, it was at the end of a long, sweaty night when they were discouraged and ready to pack it up and go home for the day. They weren't doing anything unusual for them. They were just washing their net. And at this, when Jesus comes along and enters into their normal, mundane lives and changes everything. And at this point, Jesus has been healing people, and he now has a crowd of people following his every move. And it's a teaching time again. And because of the large crowd, and because they didn't have a microphone system at the time, and the sounds carries really well on water, Jesus got into Simon's boat and asked him to put that boat back into water. And Simon made perhaps the most important decision of his life. Even though he was tired, even though he was frustrated, even though he didn't feel like it, he listened to Jesus and served Jesus by putting his boat out to shore and letting this stranger teach this crowd of people from his boat. Then, after Jesus gets finished with teaching, he says the strangest thing to Simon. He tells Simon, this professional fisherman who hasn't caught a thing all night, to take his boat out into deep water and let down the net for catch. What do you suppose was going through Simon's mind at the time? He didn't think Jesus was crazy. Did he feel a twinge of frustration? Since the nets were already clean, and he knew deep down inside that he wasn't going to catch a single fish. Did he know there was going to be an effort in futility? What do you think? In any event, Simon answered, "Master, we've worked hard all night and haven't caught anything, but because you say so, I will let down the net." It does sound like Simon just doing it to placate Jesus, doesn't it? Or maybe he's doing it so he can prove to Jesus how foolish an idea this is. Like, I will show him. I will go ahead and do it, and when nets come up empty, he will see what a ridiculous request this is. Then maybe I can get this guy off my back and go home. We don't know. I don't know, but I suspect that thought might be in there somewhere. Have you ever felt like Jesus was asking you to do something, calling you to do something, but you didn't believe it would work? You didn't think it was possible? I remember when we had the shared ministry contract ended in 2019, and the Fijian congregation moved out of this facility, there were some people who thought the Shoreline Church wouldn't survive on its own. Or when early in 2020, the pandemic hit the world and church lockdown was ordered, which lasted a year and a half. Many thought this little church on the corner was surely finished. Everyone got involved in contributing money, time, and effort, though. God's Spirit moved and worked. And this church has survived through those
harsher time in 2019, 2020, 2021. We could easily give up and close the church, but most of us wouldn't give up without putting a fight. We were able to keep the church door open and continue with the little food pantry and other mission projects. When we step out with Jesus into the deep waters, doing what he calls us to do, even if it seems an impossible task, miracles happen. Amen? We are this body of church. We are the living proof to that. And also, it changes you and me somehow. And when Simon, Peter, James, and John took the leap of faith, took the chance, did what Jesus asked them to do, even though they didn't think it was possible or didn't think it would accomplish anything, they caught such a large number of fish that their net began to break. It was a record haul. You can imagine the both boats were filled with fish. And when they did so, the boat started to sink. How would you react to something like that? I think I'll do just about what Simon Peter did. I'd fall on my knees in utter terror and say, "Get away from me, Lord. I'm a sinful man." In other words, this is something only God can accomplish, right? And to be in the presence of the Holy God, especially in the Jewish religion, it was a scary thing. You had to be clean before you could be in God's presence. And Peter knew he was not clean. But this passage of scripture gives us a new insight as to how God works. We don't have to have cleaned up our act before Christ comes knocking on our door and calling us to action. We don't have to have it all together in order for God to use us. We don't have to be perfect to be sinless for God to love us and invite us to be his disciples. We don't have to do anything. We just have to be receptive. That's all. God loves us just the way we are. God loves us just the way we are. Do you know that right now, this morning, God loves you and me just as we are? Have you been feeling about yourself this week, or this morning, or perhaps your entire life? You have been struggling with temptations and sins for as long as you can remember. Have you not? Perhaps lately, you have been especially in doubt of God's love for you. Maybe you are feeling really bad about yourself and very disconnected from God and anything holy for that matter. Perhaps you think there's no hope. Kind of like Simon, Peter, James, and John after a full night of fishing and catching nothing. Maybe you think you are beyond redemption, beyond forgiveness, beyond God's reach. I've felt like that before. And sometimes I still feel like that and have to remind myself that God loves me and is more than ready to forgive me, no matter what I have done in my life. Can you relate personally and also relate to our church situation? And so, what can we do? We return to the throne of grace. Amen?
I return to the cross of Christ, and I ask God to forgive me for what I have done. I ask God to change me. I ask God to help me to overcome whatever sins and fear I'm dealing with. And then, Lord willing, I continue on following Jesus, trusting in His forgiveness, His grace, trusting that He has made me clean. Amen? Trusting that He wants to do beautiful and wonderful things through my life, despite myself. What did Jesus say to Simon Peter as Simon covered up in fear at Jesus' feet? Simon said, he cried, "I am a sinful man." Jesus has pity and compassion on him. Jesus doesn't condemn Peter. Instead, Jesus says calmly, gently, and with great confidence, "Don't be afraid. From now on, you will fish for people. Do not be afraid." These are the words that God used to speak to people who are gripped by God's overwhelming mystery and miracle presence. And then God called us to do something for Him. And this doing, this following, this decision on our part, whether we heed the call or not, will change yours and my life forever. And it is a decision. God doesn't force us to do anything. He come ask us. It is our decision to whether to follow the call or deny it, reject it. God calls every single one of us in this church. Have you heard God calling you to follow Him? And if so, have you acted on it? Are you following Him? You know, just like Simon Peter, James, and John, God finds us whatever we are, whatever we are doing, and shows us something, often with the very things of our everyday lives. Like the disciples, we have to be open to the voice of the stranger. We must pay attention because surprising messages really do come to us virtually every day. You know, yesterday, Janer told me about a gentleman named Abel who sent an apology letter to Shoreline Church. I know many of us who have a copy of this letter in your email. It came through an email, so I want to read a portion to you. Abel's letter says like this: "Dear church ladies and others, I did something I am ashamed of that could affect you, and my conscience will not rest. I couldn't sleep and have been at war and myself all day and filled with remorse, and I just want to tell you and apologize and ask for your forgiveness. I made a foolish choice and I want to make it right if I can. I was out for a walk before bed and I saw your outdoor sign, the one that says, 'Smile, there's hope.' And I felt a wave of cynicism and depression and hit that moment. So I chose to alter the sign, switching the H with a D. So you would say, 'Smile, there's a dope.' I thought it would be funny, but I was immediately consumed with guilt and regret. I could not sleep. So I returned
and switch the letters back. But it was like that for maybe an hour, and people probably saw it even in the dead of night. I feel like such a silly person. It was not funny, and it was not okay for me to change your message of love into the crude joke about drugs. That is not the message you are trying to put out into the world. And I had no right to be so disrespectful. And it's made it worse because my spouse and I routinely use your little free pantry to get by. And I just feel like such a fool. It was an immature stern that served no purpose. I am feeling super ashamed. No one deserves to be treated unkindly just because I am having a bad day. I have received nothing but love from your church. Even as a total stranger, I repaid that with a moment of senseless vandalism. I hope I corrected it before too much damage was done. I want to offer my real apology and commitment to not to do something like that again, and to ask if you can please forgive me. If there is any way I can make amends for this, I would like to do that. I don't know what, if anything, would make restitution. I just know that I have to say something and be prepared to own up to the consequences. With humility and regret, Abel. I only read a portion of the letter to you. If you want to read the whole letter, just ask Jeanette. She will be more than happy to share it with you. So I sent following reply to this brother in Christ. Hi Abel, my name's Kevin. I'm a pastor of Shoreline UMC, your neighborhood church. I want to thank you for your letter. It was beautifully written. You don't need to feel sorry for what you have done, because God knows that we are all sinners, and He doesn't condemn us. He doesn't beat us over the head about whatever sins we've done. Instead, God loves us just the way we are. Dear brother in Christ, I admire you for your courage to step forward. Many of us live with a plank in our own eyes and criticize someone for a speck in that person's eye. We don't have the courage to admit our sins, and myself being one of them. I will pray for you that God will restore peace in your heart. Just trust God's forgiveness, His grace. Blessings. My fellow brothers and sisters in Christ, God has a job for us to do. He hasn't given up on us. It's a job that involves helping other people, showing them the love of Christ, and maybe, just maybe, changing their lives and your life as well. Don't be afraid. From now on, you will fish for people, Jesus told these astonished disciples. And so they pulled their boats up on shore and left everything, including this record catch of fish, worth maybe a fortune, and followed Jesus on their way to change the world. They never would have dreamed or believed the miracles that they would see, live in, and how they would be used to start the Church of Jesus Christ. What has God called you to do? Have you heard His voice calling you to come?
follow him and do whatever it is that he has planned for you that would involve the bringing love and his message to the world. Come. Leave whatever you need to leave behind and follow him. Let us pray. Lord, like the disciples, we too may become afraid when confronted with your call on our lives. We might just think that we aren't up to the task, but the call is from you to us. And you wouldn't call us to do something that you won't do and accomplish through us. May we not shrink before the mystery of your call. May we not choose the mundane over sacred just because it seems easier. Help us, O God, make the decision to follow you wherever you lead. We are here, we are ready, we are yours. You are more than able, God. Let it be. Let it be. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's pray for a few minutes in silence.
And now it's time for our announcements. And our announcement this morning, we still have our year statements that Stephanie provided, which is at the back. If you need a copy, you can take a copy with you. Ladies Bible study is tomorrow night. And snacks for students. We have a box at the back. See that the box has been filled, and thank you for those who brought snacks and remember to bring this morning. And we would like you to help out. It says here, for our local high school students in need, many high school students are experiencing food insecurity. Or they can use a snack when they are struggling and they visit the counseling office at school. Please consider donating. And the donation is nutrition bars, granola bars, trail mix at Costco and Trader Joe's, and fruit bars, individual wrapped meat sticks, and individual packed nuts. Popcorn, Costco, Trader Joe's sells individual packages. And those will be very much appreciated.
Amen.
And thank you, our little church at the corner. And if any of us are tested positive of COVID, we can let our church know. Senior Pastor and Janelle and Alicia, and they will take the appropriate action to help us stay healthy. Thank you. Any other announcement? Oh, another announcement. We have a young man here sitting with us today. He's been here for a couple of Sundays, and he has decided to join the church. Can you stand up and...
Thank you, Riley. You're welcome.
Welcome.
God bless you.
Yes, thank you. And Greg is here.
Uh-huh.
Thank you, Greg.
Oh, hi, Greg. How are you? Oh, So glad to see you. I'm sorry I didn't see you earlier. Go ahead.
Any other announcements?
I just want to thank you for a number of you who reach out into your wallet and shared your money for petty cash. When I shared with you a couple of weeks ago that we need some petty cash in the office, so when people in need come and ask for bus fares and a few dollars to buy themselves for lunch, whatever, and a number of you came to me after that sharing and hand me cash. So I keep them in my office and I will be ready to share your love and love of God to those in need. So thank you and God bless you.
And thank you very much. Now we will invite our ushers to come forward for our offering and tithes. For those of us who are able, may we stand for our doxology.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise God of creatures here below. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Praise God, the source of all our gifts. Praise Jesus.
Loving God, we have been blessed with so much through your goodness. As we bring our gift in gratitude this morning, you remind us that it doesn't matter what we have in our life. If we do not have Jesus, we have nothing. Without Jesus in our life, we could work hard all night and could not catch anything. But Lord, when you say so, and we obey you and let down the net, we will see miracles. Open our eyes and our hearts, O Lord. In Christ Jesus, our everything, we pray. Amen. God did not say that it would be easy to bring the good news to all people. But God did say that God would be with us. So let us go now in peace, walking humbly with God. Bring the good news of hope to all those who are in despair. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Amen. And now our closing hymn, My Faith Looks Up to Thee.